Hi, and welcome to another episode of HippoBrain. Here is where we have hippo-sized conversations with people with hippo-sized brains. Today's a very, very, very interesting one because it's really very different. Normally, companies work on a simple principle. Buy as low as possible, sell as high as possible. Today, we're trying to understand, and I only say trying to because I really don't think I'll ever be able to understand or fathom the entire breadth of operations that this company does. But this company's mission is completely reverse. It is to buy as high as possible raw materials and sell as low as possible. If you could guess the name of the company, that'd be quite interesting. But Rajesh, over to you to explain the company that we're going to try and understand. And of course, the man who's going to lead us through it.
Thank you very much, Jaimit. Okay, so before people guess, here's another clue. Their products are something which all of us use, and their ads are something which we all love. So today's guest, if you haven't guessed yet, is Jayen Mehta from Amul. Jayen is senior GM planning and marketing. And I have to start with a very interesting story of how Jayen and I connected with each other. I was running India World. This was 1996. We had launched the portal about a year ago. Previous to that, the Cricket World Cup was coming up at that time. And then I get a call one day from Anand. The person on the line was Jayen. I didn't even really know much about Anand other than that it was a station between Bombay and Ahmedabad. And Jayen calls me up and says, you know, you have your India World site. We want to reach NRIs. The Amul topical, the Amul ad, which we are all so familiar with. He wanted that placed on all our on our cricket sites ahead of the World Cup. And that's how Jayen and I connected for the first time. I actually met him a year after that in Anand. And the one line which I remember, his boss at that time, Mr. Vyas, who was the MD of GCMMF, Gujarat Cooperative Milk Marketing Federation, the organization which, of course, owns the Amul brand, said to me, think of us as an IT company in the foods business. And that's the spirit which has kept Amul at the forefront of the technology revolution all these years. Welcome to HippoBrain, Jayen.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Rajesh and Jaimit, for the kind words of introduction. I'm also going 25, 30 years back in history. And I very fondly cherish the first association that we had and continuing to do so with you over all these decades. The story of India World has been very interesting. We actually went live on your page on 9th of March, 96, the day India and Pakistan were playing the quarterfinal, which India won, of course. And that's how the association started. And we were at that time pretty clueless of what do we put on the website. I mean, it's good to have something there or be present there. But then we thought the topical was the easiest way to connect with the millions around the world. And that's how we put the topical there. Then you said something else has to come with the topical. You need an Amul story. So we didn't have a story per se, but then we figured out that on 3rd of March that day, that year, there was an article in Asian Age. It's called the Amul topical story. So we typed it immediately. We never took permission from Asian Age or the author, Mimi Verma. And even today on Amul.com, that story and that article is there with this date to remember that we started our web presence way back in 1996. But thanks to you, we were amongst the first five corporates in India to have a .com presence. And we started, the Amul.com. And prior to that, this association with you, the kind of warm feedback we got instantly from around the world was really, really, really huge. And after that, Jaimit, with Rajesh, we did very, very interesting things. Something like an Amul World Cricket Rankings. Also had an AmulMail.com. Can you believe? I mean, we had a mail service. More than 30,000 people who were live and active in about 6 months we started. We also had India's first cyber store. Okay. And that was again hosted on Amul.com. Rajesh gave us the idea for that. And we had 50 offices there and about 100 cities were connected. Imagine we are talking of 97, 98 when India's first .com webmart or India Plaza, whatever it was, had not started. Customer could go online, click on the product. The mail would go to my branch office. The branch office will communicate to the nearest distributor and distributor will come and deliver the products to your store.
1998. You were, Amul was Ecom Live.
Yes, live in 100 cities. And after 6 months, we were live on ice cream also. So even today, except for Big Basket, and that too in few cities, is able to do ice cream delivery at your home. It's basically a frozen product. We were doing it 20 years back. I mean, that was the audacity we had. Okay, without having email connection everywhere. I mean, our distributors were not online. Mobile phones were new in those days. But then Amul cricket rankings were very interesting. And later we had an Amul.tv webpage. And that was in 2004, December. Remember, YouTube came in this January 2005. So year prior to that, we had a streaming thing. We were streaming Manthan, Sardar, all our ads, everything on Amul.tv. And that's the kind of content, the obsession with content, let me put it that way, we had. And that way, it was able to help us connect with a lot of people and get a good traction on that. So that is the India world side of the story. Rajesh has moved much ahead, but he continues to guide us. He was powering our emails, internal email services also. A lot of other things related to SMS, messaging to customers, messaging to trade partners and all that. So it's wonderful, wonderful to see both of you.
I had no clue, Jayen. I knew Amul was up there. And I remember in those days, I remember Amul being there on digital advertising and all of that. But what you're talking of e-com, you're talking of all these connections, Amul TV... You could have demerged this business and listed it for $1 billion.
We were not as smart as Rajesh.
I think it's a fascinating story, Jain. Even I had forgotten some of these things. You brought it all to life. But I think that's the spirit. You have had always had personally, I mean, the curiosity, the cutting edge, all of it put together. I think I'll take you back 30 years. You graduated from IRMA, Institute of Rural Management at Anand, and you joined Amul 30 years ago. And you've stayed at the same organization for 30 years, a lifer at Amul. What made you join Amul at that time and what's made you stay on?
Perhaps not employable elsewhere. So that's why I'm still around.
Nice one, Jain.
but the key thing is, I mean, it's never felt like I'm doing a job. So good part is people, I don't know how why people leave jobs because I've never left one. But here, there's not been a single day of boredom. I mean, we've been having new products, new challenges, new processes, new things to do every single day. So even today, when I come to office every day, I'm not sure how the day is going to end. Because while things remain as, I mean, we want things to remain as predictable as possible, there is a lot of new and exciting things. And as Dr. Kurian used to say, I mean, there is not a day without a challenge in his life. And imagine if he was so big a man with so great stature, I think we have our own share of problems and challenges also day in and day out. Having said that, I was born in Bombay, but brought up in a small town called Viravel Somnath. And my father worked all his life in your Indian group company, the Birla company, Indian Rayon. And my mother also was a school teacher and later a principal in a school run by the same company. So, and then after 15 years, after doing class 10 in Veeraval, I moved on to Ahmedabad to do a couple of years of A+2. And then I got an admission in engineering post class 12. I got admission in architecture also. But then my uncle guided that I also got an admission in BBA, that's Bachelor of Business Administration in Vallabh Vidyanagar, one of the premier management colleges and undergrad levels in those days, and even today also. So then rather than architecture, he said, why don't you try BBA? It's a good course and you will have some better learnings there. So I joined there and I did well there. I had gold medal in the university. And then after BBA, you need to do master's. So options was doing management, MBA, and then IRMA also came up. So I gave the entrance and Anand, being close to Vallabh Vidyanagar, I joined IRMA after having got admission there. I did well there also. I was the third ranker in my batch of 80, the topper in management and in marketing management stream there. But both in graduation and under graduation, my passion remained technology and computers in those days. So the first brush with computers I had was in the year 1984 when I left Veeraval and joined Ahmedabad. There is a Vikram Sarabhai Community Science Center in Ahmedabad, and they used to teach basic programming course. So I tell my colleagues that I am not a digital dinosaur as you expect me to be. And I'm carrying this certificate with me, which was issued to me then when I completed the course of basic programming.
Okay. Seriously, so
what our kids today talk about coding, basic programming was the most elementary thing which I did those days. And then in graduation, I took my second after marketing as the main discipline. Computer science was the second. In Irma also, we had a great PC lab, great colleague, my classmates and great faculty. And the second subject I had was computer science and simulations and so on and so forth. So that way, the obsession with data, relationship, data management, computers and all was there. But obviously, internet was not there in those days. But then passing out of Irma in campus recruitment, Amul was the most chosen company or most sought after company in those days. And I had an obsession with marketing also for all these years. So this was the best fit I had. And I joined as a product manager and was given a very, very challenging product to begin with, which was an Amulya Dairy Whitener brand, a just launched brand, not doing well as compared to Nestle, which was the main competitor with its brand Everyday Dairy Whitener. Amul had a flagship product called Amul Spray, which is a baby food you could not advertise. And there Nestle was trying to hit with the Everyday and get away the market share of the Amul Spray baby food because it was partly used as a dairy whitener or milk powder also. So the challenge here was to build Amulya as a brand and fight with Nestle, which was the foremost competitor. So from 1,000 tons in the first year, second year, my volumes doubled to 2,000, third year, 4,000, 6,000, 8,000. Today, we are number one brand by far. And we've been able to not only protect the milk powder category, but also keep Nestle steady in one of the core dairy product businesses. So, and then I moved on. I handled Thara range of edible oils. NDDB was the principal, GCM was the distributor. So between 95 and 2000, I handled Thara. I was head of exports since 1995. So for the last 25 years, I've been looking after exports, advertising, and then the digital and other things also was a natural extension to what I got the opportunity to do here. And then we got into a lot of other things also, but the passion is still of a brand manager of media. I mean, trying to understand media and leverage my or the brand's presence accordingly. I'm grateful that you got a Dudhwala on the show. You now almost 25-30 shows, but happy to be here and at least sharing a part of the journey and part of the story that we have.
Yeah, Jain. Yes, we are extremely happy to have a Dudhwala. A 52,000 crore Dudhwala, is the number right?
Yes. That's true. That's true. The brand. I mean, every brand has a story. And fortunately for us, the story is very, very interesting. Because Amul started and Amul was registered as a cooperative in 1946, almost a year before our independence. And it was a struggle of the local milk producers here. They were exploited by a private company called Polson. It was supplying milk to Bombay and they were exploiting the farmers by not paying a good price of milk. Like in summer, if milk is short, they would pay a good price. In winter, since the milk is more, and they would reduce the price of milk and the farmers felt exploited. So they went to Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel and told that this is a dilemma, please help us out. So Sardar Patel told them that you have to form a cooperative society. And once you are organized, nobody will be able to challenge to you. So they went on a strike for 15 days. The British government then had to buckle and give them a registration of as a cooperative society. So in December of 46, the Kera District Cooperative Milk Producers Union was registered. And then actual revolution happened, started from 1949 when Dr. Kurian, who had done his post-graduation in US, Michigan, on a government scholarship, was given a charge to look after the government creamery in Anand, which was actually not working. So the Amul Dairy, the original plant and so on, were very close to that. So he was watching what these farmers were doing. So, and then Tripondas Patel, who was the chairman of then cooperative, a very selfless farmer leader, he took help of Dr. Kurian, saying that you've studied abroad, please guide us what to do because we have a lot of milk, we don't know what to do. Dr. Kurian guided them to take a pasteurizer and so that the shelf life of milk is extended and then you can sell it at a longer distances. So he took Dr. Kurian to Bombay, negotiated the pasteurizer, and we heard Dr. Kurian was wanting to get out of Anand after 6 months of his internship was getting over. Then, since the goods had not arrived, Tribhuvanadas Patel persuaded Dr. Kurian to stay on, and Dr. Kurian stayed on. And like most startups, you know, started in a garage, but they were building wealth for themselves. Dr. Kurian lived in garage for his initial years in Anand and built this startup, which still we retain the mindset of a startup called Amul, which has reached this scale levels of about 52,000 crores in turnover last year. That's under the Amul brand. We are ranked the 8th largest dairy company in the world in terms of processing capacities. Rabobank has listed as the 16th largest in terms of the sales turnover. And remember, we are only operating largely out of one state of India, which is Gujarat. And the number 1 to 7 are actually multinationals operating in multiple geographies or large countries. So that way, to come up to this ranking has been a struggle which our milk producers, their leaders, and right from Dr. Kurian, all the senior leaders of GCMMF have actually put in their heart and minds to make this brand a big one. But in end of the day, the credit goes to 36 lakh farmers on this side and millions of customers on this side who blindly trust Amul and make it as valuable and precious as it is today.
Then I want to go back to what Jaimit said at the start, the uniqueness of the Amul model. Buy at the highest possible price and sell at the lowest possible price. Let's talk about that. Explain us how that works.
That is the operating philosophy here. The reason why a private company buys at the lowest price and sells at the highest price is it wants maximum profit. And it wants maximum profit for its owners or the investors. That's very simple business management logic. Here we are buying it, the raw material, which is 80% of what you pay in Amul products goes back to producers at the cost of milk. So we are buying it from our owners. So obviously, since you're buying from owners, you can't negotiate and ask them to sell at the lowest price. So you have to pay the highest price to them. We, on the other side, have a mandate to build the market also. Now, Amul butter has an 80-85% share of the Indian market. Cheese has more than 65% share of the market. Milk powders, baby food and all, we have 70-80% share of the market. Milk, we are market leaders in all the markets. So a brand which is a monopoly can charge any price technically and get away with it for the time being, in the short run. But here we know that if we are able to build the market for each of these products, what we are doing in effect is building the future of the milk producers, because once they get higher price of milk, they will remain interested in this business. They will invest into more cattle. They will produce more milk. And once more milk comes, then we also should be able to sell this under a variety of forms and products. So it is basically an objective to A, win market share on this side by giving the best quality products to the customers at the most affordable prices. India has a big bottom of the pyramid. So while many people would buy butter today, but there are many who are aspiring to eat butter tomorrow. Big butter penetration in India, all said and done, is not more than 25% today. Cheese is less than 10%. Okay, so there's a huge opportunity. Ice creams, huge opportunity. Butter, cheese, ghee, milk powders, liquid milk, any product you name, there's an opportunity here. Because as the country becomes more and more affluent, the GDP increases, purchasing power increases. Obviously, you are going to consume less of staples and more of proteins or value-added products. And that's where we fit in. So, and if when we started, I mean, from zero, we are now close to, say, 250 lakh liters of milk a day. And about 25% of total organized milk in India is handled by Amul. And India is roughly 20% of the world's milk production. Now, what Dr. Kurian did and what led to Indian success story is not just the Amul model. He replicated the Amul model across India in all 28 states. So you hear of a Verka brand from Punjab or Nandini in Karnataka or Avin in Tamil Nadu or Ilma in Kerala and so on. All the 28 state federation brands are born out of the Amul model. So he empowered milk producers across India. They are selling under their own brand, but the model, the three-tier pattern, which is a village cooperative society, a district milk processing union, and the state marketing federation, all are owned by the farmers of the respective states. And like we have the system of 36 lakh farmers or 3.6 million farmers organized into 18,500 village cooperative societies and 18 district unions having 84 dairy plants. Okay, and we handle 250 lakh liters of milk. The country, the other dairy cooperatives, there are about 180,000 village cooperative societies in India. And these cooperative societies do the same work what we do in Gujarat. and the milk which comes are sold under the respective cooperative brands. And together, because of this structured model, what was replicated under what is called an Operation Flood program between 1970 and 1996, India became the largest producer of milk in the year 1998. Now, today, we are selling almost double the milk that what USA is producing and slightly more than what entire Europe is producing. Okay, and which is 20% of the world milk. Now, another 10 to 15 years, and we have seen projections from different organizations globally, be it FAO or IFCN or our own internal projections, India will be about 1/3 of the total milk in the world. More than 30% of the total milk in the world will be produced in India by the year 2033. And if incremental milk production, if you calculate from today till 2033, if it is 250 million metric ton, 150 will come from India only. And if that comes and the share of the organized sector increases, Amul also by 2030 from the current 250 lakh liters per day will go up to 450 lakh liters per day. So that is the way in the scale and size in which we plan. We have a perspective to build market for every single product, but that can happen only when the producer gets the best price of milk. And with changing times, dairying is a 24/7 business. A person having a cow cannot take a holiday, because somebody has to look after a cow, rear that cow every day. So you have to keep the next generation involved into dairying, use automation, technology wherever is possible so that the life becomes easy, drudgery is less. And if he earns good money in his village, there is no need to migrate to larger cities and live in slums and work as a laborer here in a city as compared to your owner of a $7 billion brand sitting right in your own village. And then once you nurture your cattle, the prosperity increases. There is a daily income, okay? And it's a daily transfer to your bank account. And there is whole lot of transparency. Technology also has been bought in a very big way, that every single liter of milk that we collect across 18,500 villages, every farmer gets an SMS that you poured in 4 liters of milk, your fat content was 7%. And at the current price of say 700 rupees kg fat, this is the money has been deposited in your account. On an app, he can see it. So even it doesn't matter if an 8-year-old child goes to deposit that 4 liters of milk, the lady who runs the house on her phone gets a message. And that's a kind of transparency in quality, in pricing, and the entire business has been done. Now imagine more than 2 million SMSs going every day, morning, evening, across all the villages of Gujarat. And it's app-based system also. So you have an app, you can see the same data on your app. And then use that goes into the big data flow. Maybe we can discuss that later. So, but the key thing here is, if the farmers who are the owners remain interested in the business grows, we don't treat them as suppliers, they are the owners. And the owners deserve the best price. And so is this big stakeholder, which is a customer. And if customer feels that Amul gives the best quality product at the most affordable prices, there'll be a blind trust. And that is the trust actually which wins the hearts of the minds of the customers and makes the brand a bigger brand. And just one thing aside, I would like to mention here. We all know marketing, the 4 P's of marketing, the product, price, place, promotion. That's what Philip Kotler taught us since 1960s. And all of us have been students of marketing of these 4 P's. This year, the 5th P has come, which is pandemic, which is the challenge which all of us are going through. But aside from that, Amul's logo has basically 4 hands. If you could that look at the logo, there are 4 hands and 4 people joining hands. Now, these are the 4 hands which Dr. Kurian conceptualized in those days. One of the farmer, that is the milk producer. Second is of the processor. Third of the marketeer. And fourth of the consumer. So if you look at all the 4 stakeholders as equal partners in your business, Amul does not say, okay, no, it works only for the producers because it's a farmer owned 36 lakh farmers, they demand terms. No, the stakeholder is also a consumer. It's also the marketeer, which means the retailer also, the distributor also, the sales team, which markets also is equal stakeholder. And the fourth is the processor, which is the dairy plant, the processing people, the technologies, and so on and so forth. So since 1946, it was conceptualized that we will look at the entire business spectrum, not from a selfish point of view, that it's me, myself, or the cooperative works only for itself. It works for all the 4 stakeholders. And that makes this brand very, very unique. And obviously, it forces the entire organization to remain dynamic.
So, Jain, it's amazing how the passion and the aggression which we see, and it's also what we see as a consumer on the field. Amul products are typically the price aggressive warriors, as I would say. I see you and I talk to you and I realize there is an aggression. But it's very easy today to be this big giant monolithic. You practically don't have shareholders to report to. So who are asking every day growth kya hai? There is no quarterly pressure in that sense. It may be very difficult to get that aggression from inside. And to do it for 60 years, in some ways, 60, 56, 70 years, yes. How do you manage that? And I hear you when we were speaking to you, there were Japanese techniques of management that you brought in. There's something that you bring that aggression always to the table. Can you shed light on how is it possible for a company that is possibly not owned by any shareholder, putting a gun on its head, etc., to consistently be aggressive and be this quality conscious and be so focused on pricing?
That's a good point. But I'm reminded of a joke, actually, when one guy was being rewarded that you saved this person who was drowning. People were on a ship and there was one person drowning, and then one guy jumps in and he saves the person who was drowning, and he's felicitated for that. But after the felicitation was over, he asked this question, ki mujhe dhakka kisne mara? Okay, so this was a typical thing which happened. This is a typical thing which happened in Amul. I'll narrate the incident. It's my personal experience also, so that's why I can say that more credibly. When I passed out from Irma in 1991, it was Dr. Manmohan Singh who had come in as a deputy chief of planning commission, and he gave us our degrees. And that was March of 1991. In May 1991, he becomes the finance minister of India. And the first thing he does is liberalizes the economy. Now, once you have a liberalized economy, technically, money can come from abroad, investors will bring in money from abroad, and any private company or a multinational can put its dairy plant next to Amul dairy plant in Anand. Okay, because there was no other restriction, and otherwise cooperatives and dairy industry was otherwise preserved because the government realized this is the model. And I was talking with Operation Flood also going on in that era. Now, suddenly, I'm talking of myself, that you studied in supposedly a socialist era. Irma is an institute with Dr. Kurian Bate. We had the best teachers who have studied in IIM Ahmedabad, FPM, PhDs, and so on and so forth. We case study method, Harvard cases, and so on and so forth. But the mindset was basically rural and how to help rural producers, rural people, and so on. And nobody expected that the contours of the economy will change, policies will change, and government will suddenly say, hey, look after yourself. Okay, so and when you joined in May 1991 in Amul, in the first job, in the first month, you realize that what you studied and what you need to do is totally different. And so we as an organization understood the entire scenario and said that we'll have to change as per the changing times. And Amul as a brand has to become more savvy and so to say, have strategies to cope up with the changing times and environments. And that's why we looked at multiple options. And we've realized that the Japanese tool of management, which is the TQM model, which has multiple components like kaizens, housekeeping, small group activities, and more importantly, what is called a Hoshin Kanri. So Hoshin Kanri is a process in which you deploy the strategy, but align everyone in the organization to a particular goal of the organization. And so we have these Hoshin meetings. We have been having these Hoshin meetings since 1995. In which for 4 days from morning 5 o'clock till late evenings, there used to be debate amongst all the branch managers of the organization, the zonal sales heads, the brand managers, the manufacturing unions, the departmental heads, about 100 and 150 people led by the managing director would discuss every single product of the organization, every single process of the organization. So we have been doing this for the main dairy product business twice a year since last 25 years. One separate Hoshin meeting for the fresh product business for the last 15, 20 years when this product has become big, and also for ice cream for the last 25 years. So thorough manthan happens and in which the managing director starts with setting the direction of the organization for the next 6 to 12 months. Okay, we have a long-term plan also. So in 1995, first time, we made a plan for the year 2005. That this is where we want to see this organization to be. And what Rajesh mentioned about working like an IT company in food business was one of the 7 strategic thrust areas that we had in those days. Okay, others being related to customer, the others to producer, cooperation among cooperatives, and so on and so forth. But IT integration, way back, I mean, we are talking 5 years before the Y2K and the Indian IT revolution, but we realized that was one of the steps. So the first 5 year, 10 year plan was in from 1995 to 2005, in 2005, 2010, 2020, and now 2030. So on a long-term plan, we break it down to short-term plans, look at every single activity and process of the organization, every single product, where it is, where it's supposed to go, and who's the competition and what is the changes happening in that particular space. What are the new plants, manufacturing technologies, upgradation processing capacities, the investments to be made, all this being discussed continuously between all the stakeholders. And so what we discuss, and so once the managing director sets the direction of the organization and takes a particular goal, every employee in the organization is supposed to identify what is the my role to achieve this particular goal of the organization. So it is by and large a model of a self-managed leadership. So every day when I come to office and when I have a team of 30 people reporting to me, or I'm in sales branch and I have 12 salesmen and 40 distributors working with me, it's not that the leader or the head or the functional head has to tell everyone ki tumko aaj ye karna hai. The person who is there has already in the beginning of the year identified that for brand X to reach this particular level, if I'm the brand manager, I'll do this. If I'm the purchase manager, I'll do this. If I'm looking after this packaging in purchase department, I'll do this. If I'm advertising, this I will do this. If I'm a POP, I'll do this. Same thing we cascade to our distributors also. So every product we launch, we tell in advance to our distributors and their salesmen in similar Hoshin cascading meetings across all the 70 branches of the country so that they also know 6 to 12 months in advance that the company is going to do this or is going to change this process. We are going to have a DMS-based selling system in which automation in selling is going to happen and so on and so forth. So with this, what happens is there is no need to supervise everybody's activities on a day-to-day basis. We review what that this was the Hoshin you took, where what is the current status. The management's responsibility now becomes to be a provider. Because you don't need to spend your time directing people, aaj ka kaam ka kitna hua, iska hisab do, ye do. We don't need to do that. We only say that if you know, you said you wanted to do this task, what resource you want. So the organization spend, the leadership or the top management spends the maximum time on nurturing team which is has taken up a particular challenge or an activity to meet the overall goal of the organization and provide resources what are required for them to achieve that. So since all this happens, or so to say, the negotiation also happens between brands and so on, but it is all decided much in advance. And so the day-to-day task is only operations in terms of execution. If there is anybody has a challenge, he will go to the higher management. It's a very, very flat organization. I mean, anybody can call up my managing director. There are common WhatsApp groups in which everybody responds and reacts to everything what is happening, and everybody knows that this has happened in one remote corner of the country, and this is what we need to do. So be it price change of competitors, introduction of new product, introduction of a new POP material, any sales scheme, any support, anything is very, very transparently communicated across the organization. And in fact, my MD receives more than 10 to 15 direct calls from the customers also, distributors also, retailers also.
Your MD receives 10 to 15 calls.
Our MD, Dr. Sodhi, receives 10 to 15 calls directly from customers every day. And customers can be an end consumer, it can be a retailer, he can be a distributor. And so obviously, he has his ears and eyes on the ground. Okay. And then while we travel, there's a different issue of meeting people. But the point here is that it's a flat organization. The top management is extremely experienced. Now, Mr. Sodhi spent 38, 39, his first batch Irma, I'm 10th batch Irma. So almost 40 years in Amul, first job. Our CEO, Mr. Jala, also. Equal senior veteran, and so that way the entire organization at least ensures that we are able to work with young professionals who are recruited from the top campuses from IRMA or IIMs or MICA. They join at the senior executive level. There's a batch of about 40 people every year which come at this level, and they become and they are groomed as senior leaders. So if you are just passing out of any of these institutes, joining Amul, in a couple of years you're handling a 500,000 crore brand or a 500,000 crore branch. Okay, and that is the kind of responsibility they get at a younger age. The management processes and systems are designed to empower them. And the entire organization is run only on a very, very simple value, which is integrity. So somebody asked Dr. Kurian, that what are the three things which you value in a professional? And he said it's only integrity, integrity, and integrity. So there is nothing like it's either black or white. There is nothing gray. And this is one dictum everybody has to religiously follow. Apart from that, the other strategic thrust areas are there. Other guiding principles are there. But the value-based management focusing on professionalism through integrity is what makes Amul a very unique organization. And because of this, we've been able to not only retain good people for a long number of years, our partners are also long life partners. Both our advertising agencies, Mr. Sylvester Dikuna actually started working on Brand Amul way back in 1960. And he still is very much around handling our product and brand. His son Rahul Dikuna does the Amul topicals, which Rajesh mentioned. We don't approve that topical. You see it. I mean, I see it at the same time when you see it. Okay, so that much trust is there in an agency on a campaign which is always on the edge. Okay, it may ruffle somebody's feelings, but then everybody knows that it is not malicious. It is what the public sentiment is, but that is the trust we have given to the agency. And same with Ulka, Mr. Shashi Sinha, Nitin Karkare. They are at a very high level in their respective organizations, looking after national and international responsibilities. But when it comes to Amul, they own the brand. So that way, if our communication is in safe hands, the media team is in safe hands, and the organization is flat, run with professionals with that vigor and dynamism through a tool which is a very structured way called the Ocean Canary. This makes this brand, in a way, we can calibrate the aggression we want to in terms of products, processes, markets, competition, defending a market, taking aggression to take new market share or launch new products and get new markets.
So Jain, end mein, ye bahut hi complicated question hai, dhakka kisne mara? And answer is, kisi ne nahi mara. Hum log sab aisa ek structure bana diya. We made such a strong structure and which is so interconnected that there is no choice. But tum marte raho and you keep pushing. Is that a fair articulation?
So, and now the other part of that is the farmer side. Okay. Now our board is, all the 18 chairmen of the 18 district unions are ex officio on the board of the GCMMF. And the GCMMF and the management is, professionals are represented by the managing director. So 18 farmers and one MD, say Dr. Sodhi. So he, when, whatever proposal.
That would be a very fun meeting. That would be extremely fun meetings.
I'll tell you, I was in charge MD of Amul Dairy. And similarly, there was a board of 16 farmers and one MD there. And you had to every month talk to them about the progress of the organization in terms of the price, the products, the activities you do, the P&Ls and so on and so forth. But end of the day, what the MD of a union faces or MD of the federation faces is, ke rate kya hai doodh ka? Yeah, what is the price of milk we will get? Because that they measure the performance of the organization only on the price of milk which is paid to the farmers. Okay, they will pass decisions of investment of a 300 crore new plant in Rohtak or a 500 crore investment here or new mother dairy expansion at Rajkot. No issues. They say if the professionals have put together the numbers, they know if milk is going to come, you need to process that milk. I mean, they don't need to be told what is to be done. But end of the day, they will ask you, is rate is price of milk.
Deti kitna hai?
Yes. So that is what our MD, Dr. Sodhi, faces that every day, every board meeting, or that's the only thing he has to figure it out. And that is why, see, since we can't control the raw material price because you have to pay the higher price, we have to operate with very, very low costs and overheads. Okay, so Amul advertising budget has never been more than 1% of the turnover. Now that 1% becomes very large is a different issue, but there's a cap to that. If you are a private company in food business or a multinational, you will spend 5 to 12% of your turnover on advertising. We just pay 1%. We don't have to pay any royalty to anyone. Like the multinationals in India in food or any space send away millions of dollars away to their principals or the headquarters as royalty. We don't have to pay that. Our distributors get a very large share of business. So it is not that they will look at earnings per piece. If Amul margins are lower, but the volume of business is high, they make more money at the end of the day. So all our products typically have lower distributor margins, lower retail margins. Since we have size and scale, the warehousing cost, the transportation cost, all needs to be very, very looked at. So like we internally say that we start on the other side of the decimal. Never look on the right side of the decimal. Always go on the left side of decimal and count in naya paisas. Okay, and the internal joke is that paisa, the 2 paise, 4 paise, 6 paise became important when the telephone industry was in having struggle and the rate of calls dropped to so much so. But we've never moved on the other side of the decimal. All our thinking is broken down into cost per liter, cost per piece, and cost per transaction. And that's how it is. And so much so that when we negotiate the rates of newspapers and obviously the OTTs and the digital, it is always in cost per copy or cost per reach in terms of naya paisa. So that is the mindset which is there. And obviously the obsession is to cut costs so that we are able to A, either charge less to the customer or pay a higher price to the producer. The operation organization has to operate in a very lean and a thin fashion.
And Jayen, one of the key elements of this flywheel that you need to create is new products, innovation on a constant basis. Talk about that. I mean, the range of products that now Amul offers in the marketplace has expanded dramatically. The geographies that you are has expanded dramatically. I mean, how do you keep this flywheel going?
So there is a method in this madness. Obviously, new products is what we need to do because see, a competitor will enter a particular space or a mind space if he sees there is an opportunity to get into it. I'll start with the classic example of 1996 when we launched Amul ice cream. So a year prior to that, we did a nationwide survey through IMRB and asked customers that what are the kinds of what are the other products of Amul you would like Amul to introduce, because in those days we were having typically butter, the cheese, the milk powder, ghee, shrikhand, chocolates, and so on. So a very small portfolio. But then we realized that if the market economy is there and more competition come in, we need to be geared up for that. One product which most of the customers said and more than 98% people said is Amul should be there in ice creams. Now we were not in ice creams. Only a Sugam dairy in Baroda had a small plant, which was more of an experimental stage plant. Okay, but then we realized at that time Hindustan Lever was buying up. They bought in quality, Pura Kharid Liya, milk food they purchased, Cadbury ka they purchased, Dollops, and they were getting it big into the ice cream space. So that is where we realized that if we don't get into ice creams in a big way, we will lose this space, and milk and ice cream are synonymous. So we got into ice creams, and within five years, we became the largest brand of ice creams, and today we are selling about 3 to 5 times their volumes. Then each of the spaces, the carbonated space was there. So we said we need to get into milk beverages, and every single product category we tried to build from the scratch. One of the products which came in those days was dahi. Amul should come with dahi. I mean, we laughed at ourselves and the consumers. Kaun dahi packet mein kharidega? All of us buy milk, ghar pe dahi jamate. You do no need to sell a package. But when we launch package dahi, it is what has been selling. And so we are selling 500 to 800 tons of dahi every day. And every customer today is practically now buying dahi or chhas in a packet form from the market. Paneer was another product which the customers told. Okay, so every single thing when we hear from the customers, we try to implement it and launch it in our own way. And then there is sometimes a David versus Goliath story in which chocolates we were not doing so well. And I talked about 91 when we launched Amulya and launched a big way. In those days, we were spending about 70% of our advertising budget only on two products, which was chocolate and Nutramul. Okay, and both have hardly any dairy in that. Because other dairy products were in short supply, there was only butter there, which was being advertised. Others we used to advertise if the demand and supply were there. So in those days, we cut the budgets of chocolate and Nutramul, put money into dairy whiteners, milk powder, pouch milk, ice creams, and build the dairy product portfolio, and milk's volume started growing up. And then we realized that chocolate, we were losing market share. But the equity of chocolates was there in the minds of the customer. So we said that by the time Cadbury had become very big, there was no space to enter the milk space. So we reinvented the entire portfolio, worked on dark chocolate in a very big way, launched one after another variants of different dark chocolates, spent 0 rupees on advertising, just with social media and Instagram, and just listening to the customers. We built such a large portfolio. Today we are number one dark chocolate brand in the country and selling more than Cadbury by a large gap. So basically we have a multiple set of products, and we don't have an R&D lab in our office. Okay, most companies have a R&D lab in which you see people with white coat jacket doing a lot of research and all that. Here we have nothing. Okay, but there are multiple teams. So there is an ice cream team, which has an NPD team and 16 factories of ice cream, one or two, three, four different products. Then there's a butter and spreads category, in the beverages category, in the chocolates category. So each of these different product categories, be it the bakeries or the beverages and so on and so forth, continuous ideas of new product developments are coming. The best time in our office is at 6 o'clock every day when we meet our MD with our QA team with new sample of a new product. Okay. And no much research goes in.
Every day, Jain, did I hear you right? Yes, every day.
Yes, almost every day. And these days, it's much more often. During the last 7-8 months of pandemic, we launched 57 new products, about 120 new SKUs. Okay. So it's you can see practically lot of new products coming in. And that those products range from, protein drinks, if I'm allowed to say so. We are working on protein drinks. We are working on shortbread cookies, multigrain cookies, high protein cookies, breakfast cereals, milk replacer for calves, butter-based entire bakery range. Today bread you buy has vegetable oil. Soon you will get Amul bread, which is made from butter, like our butter cookies. Okay, a variety of fruit bread lassis. We are launching kulchas. We are launching hazelnut spread. We are launching biscoff spreads. Traditional sweets with modern technology. So continuous after, it's not that it's a new product engine which is there, but this is particularly the process or the method of madness that we have here. And and the MD is the best judge of the taste. And he says that agar aam aadmi ko pasand aaye, to wo product acha hai. And then again, his popular refrain is, dekho, hum to sab chote shehar mein hi hai, theek hai? तो छोटे शहर के लोगों को हमको पसंद है तो सबको पसंद होगा जरूरी नहीं है कि पेडर रोड के कस्टमर्स लाइक राजेश जैन शुड लाइक इट वी कांट रीच आउट टू हिम आल्सो ओके सो वी दैट्स हाउ वी वर्क ऑन प्रोडक्ट डेवलपमेंट एंड देन द डेयरी टेक्स इट बैक लॉन्चेस इट कमर्शियली देन वी हैव मल्टीपल डिजाइन एजेंसीज टू डू द आर्टवर्क्स डिजाइन प्रोडक्ट डेवलपमेंट पैकेजिंग वी वर्क विद मल्टीपल पैकेजिंग फॉर्मेट्स सो देयर इज नथिंग दैट एनीथिंग इज ऑल टेक्नोलॉजीज पॉसिबल आर अवेलेबल विद इन द सिस्टम एंड launch products at very, very fast rates. And more importantly, the channel partners are all aligned. So it's not that an extra effort has to be made to sell them this idea. Okay, that we launched the seltzers in October was announced in our Hoshin meeting in the month of January this year itself. Okay, so all the product prototype samples, the launch concepts, all were shared with our sales teams, subsequently cascaded with it. So if we launch a product in the middle of the pandemic also, effort to the reach out to the market and start rolling it out is not very difficult. There are challenges like any new product. Our agency, Mr. K. Kurian of Radius Advertising used to say that a new product is a new product for 3 years. So it's not just a baby. Since we produce so many, we should ignore. For 3 years, we have to continue to nurture it. And since the basic algorithm is in place, and the structure is right, the chances of successes have been relatively very, very high. Unless we've gone something very terribly wrong in the production or the processes, it's not happened, touch wood, so far. So that care we have to take because A, we have to protect the brand name of Amul also. Okay, because one bad example with a customer with Amul brand actually rubs off to the other thing. And today in social media, everybody is so vocal about everything. So if one bad experience, you will send a tweet, it gets viral and it creates a lot of other problems. We have to be very careful about that. But otherwise, quality is an obsession in our organization. So we will not do anything right from collection of milk to market of milk and end customer satisfaction till you consume the product. The quality of the product remains our responsibility. So we are extremely agile for that. And we want to ensure that there are no shortcuts. The supply chain remains as good without compromising integrity anywhere. And from farmer level who gives the 2 liters of milk to the end customer when we market or export to more than 50 countries, we have to be very, very sure that we meet all the standards and more importantly, the taste standard and the taste bud of the customer wherever we are selling.
And the taste bud of the aam aadmi.
Yeah.
But Jain, you're now 52,000 crores and plus growing. When you're releasing such a plethora of products, I have two questions. One, some of these seem to be non-dairy. Okay. So how does that fit into the overall thing? Because some of these dark chocolates, and I'm a consumer of dark chocolates, of Amul dark chocolates, and I can consume it because they are non-dairy. How does that fit into it? And especially when you're this big, certain categories become just too small. Now, if they're too small, does it really excite you or do you nurture it? Or you're putting them in the market, but you're not able to really support it or put focus on it? So these two things, if you could shed light on.
Your point is very right and valid also. But let's look at it the other way. For a size of country, which is 130 crore people and an export market, which is growing, for every most of the SKUs that we have, there are companies running on that. So for me, a badam can is a very small product in my portfolio relatively, because I may sell about 2 lakh pieces a day. I mean, it's not an earth-shattering volume. Okay, I mean, we can do without that also. But then there are four companies, and I can name them, the likes of the MTRs and so on and so forth. They thrive only on selling that badam milk. Okay, so per se, in India, for our size and scale, actually, there is nothing which is a small business. Okay. And as I mentioned earlier, we've been trained to work and think like entrepreneurs. So it is not that we think like, work like big bosses, lording over large volumes and businesses. No. Every single SKU is measured. I didn't mention about that. We have a DMS base, which is a distributor management system, and a common software in which all our distributors take orders. I mean, their salesmen take order on a common app for all the million outlets across the country. Okay, now, so we know exactly each of the 750 SKUs, what was sold in which outlet, in which market, when, what quantity, and we can do profiling of the shops also. Having said that, we have more than 10,000 Amul parlors in which practically there is zero competition, and any new product we launch, we can actually place overnight in these 10,000 Amul parlors. These are the places where you go to buy your milk, butter, cheese, and then if 5 different items are there, the shopkeeper will tell you. And we at least have a chance to talk to you about that particular product and experience, make you try and sample it out also. So with technology at that side, if we can do profiling also, that if this particular shop sells A, B, C, D, E, F items, there is a chance that I'll be able to sell out of these 10 products, the 4 of the new products. Depending on, because every outlet defines the geography of that particular thing. We have a lat long of every single outlet that we sell. And you as a customer, also, if you download a Locate Amul app on Play Store and register as a customer, you will see Amul shops within 5 kilometers of your current location, wherever you are in Bombay, Delhi, Madras, Calcutta. And when you click on every single shop icon, it's on a Google map, you will see which all Amul products are available there. Okay, so this is the tool we had. We've been developing for the last 2-3 years. Because of the pandemic, we launched it nationwide, because we thought we'll start it as an internal tool for our sales team, distributors. But then we realized people were in lockdown, curfews and so on. They wanted to know which Amul store would be having close to them. And so we launched it online, and people are using Locate Amul to find out a shop and the number, any of the 40, 50, 70, 80 SKUs of Amul available next to you. Okay, so distribution, any new launch has to be rolled out, and people should not say it's not available, because if I can't advertise on mass media, that's available there. So we go selective also in launching, like the Seltzer we have launched only in Gujarat. So today we are monitoring the retail presence of Amul Seltzer in Gujarat only in the last 1.5 months. And we know that now we have reached a threshold of, say, 10 to 12,000 outlets out of our total 20,000 outlets. So this is the time to go to mass media and build the product, or because this is a summer product, we know in mid-January, once our entire portfolio will be ready, we'll be able to do it in a big way. Now there you are competing with the likes of the Cokes and Pepsis of the world, because a carbonated drink is a new product category. Jaimit will say it doesn't fit into that dairy space. But Seltzers have a history of milk and dairy 100 years old. Now we revived that connection, replaced the caffeine and the phosphoric acid in colas with fruit drink. Okay, got a taste without any artificial additive ingredient and natural products. We launched a cola, which is a fizzy way of consuming milk. Chocolates was, as I mentioned, dark was the space we got into it, because milk space was not actually vacant. So we saw a niche in that, and we worked on building a portfolio. The key thing in chocolate case was that the equity, you ask customers Amul, and which are the 5 Amul products come to your mind? Apart from the milk, apart from ice cream, butter, cheese, chocolates used to be in most of these things. And at that time, it was dragging our equity down. So we had to get back that space as a premium chocolate in the minds of the customer. And so we launched this range of single country origin chocolates, a multiple range of dark chocolates, then 75 dark, 90 dark, and finally the 99 dark. Okay. And dark obviously doesn't have any milk into it, because that's the recipe we wanted. Get the purest of ingredients. But there, the idea was to actually shatter the monopoly of these European multinationals. Okay, we talk of two countries come to our mind when it comes of chocolates. Okay, one is Switzerland, of course, because and other is Belgium. Okay, and then the Cadburys and Nestle's of the world, so and so forth. Now, none of these countries actually grow a single cocoa bean. Cocoa bean is produced only in the equatorial region. So we said that now, if you want to give the best chocolate, give the credit of the country of origin to where the cocoa bean was produced. So with that thought, we got into a Peru, Venezuela, Tanzania, Colombia. I mean, you name the equatorial countries, we have a chocolate, including India. And that's how we got into the space. And to launch it was also a challenge, and particularly the 99 dark. Okay. Now, if I go to the market and tell a shopkeeper, this is a chocolate which is as kadwa as a zahir, and he would be clueless, it costs 150 rupees, and he will be clueless, ek piece bhi nahi rakhega, ke koi kharidega nahi aur bikega nahi, to main kya karunga? What Jaimit says was absolutely right. We launched it on Amazon. And we, through word of mouth, if I like the product, I would send a tweet, and Jaimit also likes it, he buys it, otherwise his neighborhood shop will never have that. Today, now most of the shops carry dark chocolate up to 55 or 70, but 99 was still a far-fetched tree. So we have an Amul store here in Anand. So we call it Amul Green. So Amul Green was listed on Amazon. We sold 99% dark first on that. Okay. Rajesh, believe me, this Diwali, we sold a crore rupees of chocolate in 1 month on Amazon. And most of it, about 80% of it, were 99 and 75 to 90 range.
Okay. It's crazy numbers.
It is huge. I mean, 7-8 lakh rupees a day overall that month, ended up with a crore plus rupees of chocolate sold. Okay. Amul Dark Chocolate 99 has been a bestseller on Amazon for the last 2 years.
Wow.
Look at Amazon. Number one in dark chocolate, number one in chocolate is 99. And three out of five top chocolate selling on Amazon is Amul. Okay. Now, so this was a space, if we had not taken, somebody else could have taken, but we have a state of the art plant with the Prime Minister, Honorable Prime Minister, inaugurated a couple of years back. And in 2 years, now we are going for expansion or doubling of the capacity there. Now, this was the pent up demand there. But again, without spending a single rupee on advertising, only through hearing, listening to words, customers. I have personally, I as a habit, for last 5 years, every single tweet with Amul name, every single Insta post, every single communication in social media, I have seen it myself. I mean, we don't depend on sophisticated tools, but here, basically listening to a customer, if there is a nice post somebody has shared on his Insta page or tweet, take a screenshot, share it with all the team members. And so everyone in the organization knows what every single customer is talking about Amul right now. People can be trolling us, people can be complimenting us, it's all fine. But we see it ourselves. I make a habit to see every single message live and real time every day and continuously. So we don't, I mean, you can't leave in this era. You can't, unlike the good old times of mass media, where you made a campaign, released it on Doordarshan or Star Plus, and you were all happy, that those days are different. These days are different than those days. And hearing the voice of the customer, and if you come to my chocolate plant today, we have a screen there in which all the what the messages I was mentioning, we are sharing, is there, and you will see a continuous scrolling of more than 7,000 messages on a kya bolte usko, every 3 second one message kind of loop. Okay, so the plant also takes that much passion in the product they are making, as much as the consumers are taking, and this is the voice. And Jaimit, let me also tell you one thing. If you go and order my Amazon and pay dark chocolate 99, no, we have told that you don't buy this chocolate. Can you believe? We have mentioned there very clearly, buy this buy this only if you enjoyed our 55 dark, 70 dark, 75 dark, 90 dark, then only come to 99. Okay. So with this caveat, because we knew we had to put it, otherwise people who think any chocolate Amul ka hai, achha hoga, and chocolate has the mindset of meetha, and this is zeher, and you will curse us. So so we at least made an effort to tell you, you come to this stage only after you cross this ladder of 1, 2, 3, 4, and then come to the ultimate 5. So there are challenges in marketing, but these are interesting things. Customers want to experiment. So what we learned from this, we have now got into a dark chocolate cone also. Okay, very soon a dark chocolate frostic will come. Now, these are then again dairy-based ingredients. There is a dark chocolate drink also which has come. Okay, there is a dark chocolate beverage, malted food also which has come. So once we know that this thing works, we have a, we can very logically extend to it at practically no efforts. Like we launched the haldi doodh. The haldi doodh worked out well. So we launched a haldi ice cream also. Then we said haldi ice cream hai, toh haldi cone bhi karte, toh haldi, tulsi, ginger, tino mila ke ek stick banate hai. Toh candy bar bhi ban gaya 15 rupay mein. So then star anise was a new flavor we discussed. Somebody told ke haldi, tulsi, ginger ki star anise bahut badhiya cheez hai. Abhi hum sab ne khai hai biryani mein star anise dekha hai, wo star shape ka wo. Par kaisa taste hota hai, toh kisi ko yaad nahi hai. Phir, within 3 days, our technical team made the product. It tastes so fabulous. So we launched the star anise doodh in the corona period. And then we launched a candy, ice candy of star anise also. So kals bhi kisi ko pasand aaya, chocolate mein bhi dal sakte. So issue is not that. So new product development ka process hai aur brand ka ye template hai. So, both can work well and if done right, it can give results. And to launch 99 chocolate on Amazon was, I'll go back to the product I think you like, is lactose-free milk. When we launched lactose-free milk, we did not know where the customers are. Because hardly aadha percent population ke paas lactose intolerance hota hai. Usme se aadha ko pata nahi hai ki mera ye problem hai. To usko bechne kaise jaye? Aur dukaan mein rakhunga 6 month shelf life product. If it expires, the retailer loses confidence and I lose the retailer forever. Okay. So we launched that on Amazon. And through that, we got customers in rural areas of Bhavnagar to Bihar, to Bombay, to Delhi and so on and so forth. So today, 1/3 of the total lactose-free volumes, and believe me, it's about 2 lakh packs, 2 lakh liters per month, come from e-commerce, and the other is through GT and modern format stores. So that is how we have to step-by-step build each of these niche categories. Some mass categories like launching milk in big cities is not a big challenge that way, because it's a push of distribution by setting up a new plant and so on. But niche products require a different treatment, little more support, little more nurturing, and do that. And the non-dairy part you mentioned was basically the dairy snacks that we have launched. Okay, so which has some dairy in this, the cheese popcorns or the cheese parathas and so on and so forth. But customers were looking for convenience. So agar koi party mera cheese ya butter ya paneer kharid ke paratha bana ke market mein bechega, to humare, hum kyun nahi kar sakte? We have our own competence, we have our own cold chain, and we have manufacturing facilities to do. So we should do it ourselves. So with that philosophy, we did it. And that's
how we do. Jayen, it's been fascinating in terms of just listening to the way you think. And I think it's representative of the organization and the scale and the innovation, all of these elements coming together. I think the way Amul has built its business, you know, and I think it's really the voice of the, of right from the bottom. And the voices that you're listening to at all times, you know, of the farmers, of the four hands that you talked about, the consumers. I think it's been a fascinating conversation. And I think so many takeaways at different levels. I think I go back to what I had always felt when we first spoke, you know, the dynamism that you showed, the entrepreneurial zeal that was there with that first phone call that you had made, still very much alive, probably multiplied manifold as we have seen over the years.
Jaimit, I would like to add one thing on that particular incident. We started, as Rajesh mentioned, on the 9th of March on the India World page and below the score cricket results. Rajesh, as always, was much ahead of its time. He had khel.com, samachar.com, and so on and so forth. See, we don't realize that Google is only 22 years old. And Rajesh, what it did was actually pre-Google. Okay. We all think since Google is every day in our life, we think it's been there since ages. But what we've seen and how the technology journey is there. But the point here I wanted to make was, we did not know Rajesh, abhi aaj Rajesh bhai ye hamara chala rahe ho, site bana diya, kuch to charge karo humko. So he said, aap de do jo de raha hai. He did not have a figure in mind what to charge him. We did not know how to use, what metrics to use to pay for a website and web presence he has given us, which is obviously was very valuable. Then it occurred to us that we think that we have a butter hoarding at Marine Drive in Bombay and we are paying X amount for that. So we said that let us treat this as a digital hoarding because it's on India World. And people are watching it. And so what we said to Rajesh, if it's okay with you, we are paying, say, I think, I don't know, Rajesh, it was how much, 15,000-20,000 rupees?
Yeah, it was
a month for see, Marine Drive hoarding. So we treat you like that. Will it be okay? Rajesh bola, I didn't ask for any money. Aap jo de do, theek hai. So almost after a year, we paid the first invoice. So that was his generosity and kindness.
For me, Jayen, that was editorial. I mean,
yes, exactly, exactly. And that's the challenge when we had, when we wanted it in newspapers. Okay, the hoardings in Amul is only 100 hoardings across, but we wanted to take it mass. So we talked to various newspapers. Okay, we want, please carry this on your newspapers as an ad and give us the front page position and so on. So Indian Express agreed to it. And today, even today, when you open an Indian Express, it comes on the front page just next to the masthead. Times of India was very reluctant to carry it. Nahi, hum page 3 pe hanging position kaise de sakte hain, ye toh ye hai, wo hai, and all that stuff. So 6 months of negotiations continue. Then one fine day, Times agreed. Ke hum aapka bhi lenge, toh our topical comes on page, bole, front page nahi de payenge because of layout restrictions. Ye is taraf Lakshman hai, is taraf ye hai, wo hai. Page 3 hanging de denge. Bole, theek hai, top of the corner, de dena. Then we asked them, bhaiya, kaise agree kiya aapne? Bole, nahi, nahi, we as a sales team were pushing them, but our editorial team spoke to Shekhar Gupta of Indian Express, and Shekhar Gupta said, arre, ye toh lena hi nahi chahiye, lena hi chahiye aapko, ye toh editorial hai, isme Amul kahan apne advertise karta hai. So with that, it started in TOI and now 30 newspapers and with combined reach of 3 crores. So that's the power of the topical also, which is there.
Yeah, it's thank you, Jain. Thank you for being an amazing HippoBrain. I think the speed at which you speak and the amount of information that you can throw in into a short period of time, I think it is outstanding.
Sorry for that.
Sorry, it is very good, Jain. It is absolutely brilliant because there is so much to take. I'm like taking notes. Ye kitna information hai. But it shows the power and the aggression that Amul brings to the table. It breaks all myth that a cooperative cannot be aggressive. I think it's very simple. If you bring it down, say sub everything, you bring it down to just two simple principles. Are you remunerative to your supplier? Are you valuable to your customer? Bahut hi simple hai. In board meetings, you listen to your supplier. In various forums, you listen to your customer. Making both meet is business. Abhi isme profit of it sab aa jayega. But the question is very, very, very simple. Your core two stakeholders and the two pillars of your business. So while one understands that always one talks about the farmers, you very clearly brought out the consumers as well. And once you have these two, there is no other choice but to constantly be aggressive and to not ask, धक्का किसने मारा? But हम खुद अपने आप को रोज धक्का मारते क्योंकि framework ऐसा बनाया है. And the great people who built it and the great people like you who run it, I think is outstanding. Thank you for being a great, great guest. Thank you guys for listening to us. There are various different HippoBrains that you can listen to. These are great conversations Rajesh and me have had over the last few months. Please subscribe to us and spread the word. Thank you all and have a great year ahead. Thank you.